earthquake, actually, and then I rushed out and I looked up and I seen the engine coming down, and they were away at 50 yards from my house, and the plane's away at the other end of the town.
Oh, my God, it's terrible. And then sparks, and then the whole thing went down.
In February 1990, with some others from the UK Families group, I met the American President's Commission on Aviation Security and Terrorism at the American Embassy. That was in February 1990. And at the end of that meeting, after we'd broken up, one of the members of the commission said to me, "Your government and ours know exactly what happened, but they're never going to tell."
In the beginning, a hand, a bag, and a baggage tag. And a radio that plays cassettes and has its own flip side, a bomb.
Most of what we read in the papers is true, but no official party is going to tell you what's true and what isn't true.
For 3 years, the United States and Scotland have been conducting one of the most exhaustive and complex investigations in history. Today we are announcing an indictment in the case. We charge that two Libyan officials, acting as operatives of the Libyan intelligence service, along with other co-conspirators, planted and detonated the bomb that destroyed Pan Am Flight 103. At this moment, Lord Fraser, Chief Prosecutor of Scotland, is announcing parallel charges. I have just telephoned some of the families of those murdered in Pan Am Flight 103 to inform them and the organizations of survivors that this indictment has been returned. Their loss has been ever present in our minds.
One of my family, when he going to the airport, Haurani give him one tape recorder from his sister. He said, "That's remember it from my sister. Don't forget that tape recorder." And he go in the side of him, with him like bodyguard to the airport. That's what happened with him. And give him the tape recorder, and fix everything for him here in Germany. And give it to him to the airport. And he don't know about it.
Around Coolin's Peak, the mist is sailing, the banshee croons her note of wailing. But my blue een with sorrow are streaming, for him that will never return.
I was driving along the road there. There were just pieces of something lying in the road, and nets and a bag. And when I got out of the car to shift them, I found, well, it was a luggage, a hold all, and I chucked everything off the road to get past, and I drove back up to the farm. And when I got here, there was nobody in the house at all. The door, they were away down the road, I found out later on. But when I got back, there was shoes, people's shoes, and a burst aerosol can. I can remember the mist. It was spraying about on the doorstep in front of the house. Later on, a fella landed in for I don't know if it was mountain rescue, it was a bloke with a dog, and explained what had happened, that a plane had crashed. So I went out with him, I think it was about 2 o'clock in the morning when I got back, and he had the dog maybe looking for, well, somebody, thinking there might be somebody still alive or something, or whatever. I could really see we were finding great big bits of aeroplane, and just seemed to be hundreds of suitcases. There wouldn't be, but it seemed like it at the time. And also a lot of Christmas presents that had, you know, they were perfect. There was nothing wrong with the wrapping on them or anything. I think the worst was I picked a present up, and it on the card on the outside it said, "Sorry, she couldn't be back for Christmas." I can't just mind what it was, but that really was quite sickening, to think that the lassie that was sending it would, well, she'd never be back.
Jean and I were both at home in Bromsgrove, and I was actually in my study doing a kind of family calendar with a picture for each month for various people for Christmas. And Jane called me through because she'd heard on the television about an air crash. And my first reaction was that it couldn't be anything to do with Flora, because I thought she would have been out in mid-Atlantic by that time. And in fact, of course, we didn't know that the plane had been delayed a little bit. But I just came through and we watched these dreadful pictures of the little town of Lockerbie in flames. And at that time, I think I felt it wasn't Flora's plane.
The plane did come down, actually, where houses were. Houses are not there now. It's just a big crater where the houses used to be.
There was debris falling everywhere, and I thought the whole roof was going to cave in on us at the time, but I looked out the back window, and all I could see was fires starting up, you know, just right over the whole countryside was ablaze.
I knew Flora had left that evening for the States, where she'd gone to stay with her boyfriend over Christmas. And I switched on the television just for something to look at while I made the supper, really. And there was this news flash that there had been a crash in Scotland of a Pan Am plane. Well, immediately my heart began to thump, because I knew she was travelling by Pan Am. I was sort of gripped with that icy cold fear that I think every mother has when her children are in danger.
It's just the most incredible devastation. It's just it's unbelievable. It's impossible, I think, to even imagine such an extraordinary tragedy.
We had an aircraft going out that night, a 727, which was taking various members of our company up to Lockerbie. And also we had a private aircraft to deal with, which was the American ambassador who was going up to the site.
As far as I can recall, there were about 40 people, excluding crew, on board, of which I would estimate 50% of those were known to me as Pan Am people. The others, I wasn't aware of their affiliations at all.
On the night, I was started to set up a control room, and by about between 11 o'clock and midnight, we actually had a member of the FBI in the office who came in, introduced himself to me, and sat down and just sat there most of the night, observing what was happening.
The local police force, Dumfries and Galloway, they were concerned at the swarms of Americans fiddling with bodies and, shall we say, tampering with those things that the police were carefully checking themselves. I'm not pretending that they said they are from the FBI or the CIA. They were just Americans who seemed to have arrived extremely quickly on the scene.
I was asked to go to various locations in and around Lockerbie to look for bodies. At first it was in the early hours of the morning in very high winds, about 30 or 40 miles per hour at ground level. When we'd gone down one large field and identified about 10 bodies, we thought we ought to retrace our steps and put some form of identification on them. And so the only thing I had with me was a block of small white labels and 100 or so plastic gloves, which I carry at all times as part of my usual police searching duties. And so I put a code on every one, DCF being my initials, DCF1, right through to 58 of the bodies in that particular sector. I learned later that when the bodies were taken to the mortuary, all the labels which I had put on them had been removed, with the exception of two. And those two labels were identified on photographs later on. But for all the rest, every other one had been removed and disregarded.
Very strange people popped out the woodwork very early on. Within a matter of 3 hours, there were American accents heard in the town. Over that night, there were large numbers, by which I mean 20, 25, 30 people, arrived. The next day, as somebody commented at the time, that's subtle, there was a whole bevy of people walked down the main street with blue wind cheaters and baseball hats with FBI on them. But there were a lot of other Americans in the town over the first 12 hours that weren't wearing FBI wind cheaters. I don't know who they are. I know who some of them were, and they certainly weren't tourists.
In the morning, when more cameras have arrived, it is the turn of the dignitaries, a junior prince and the Prime Minister herself.
There are bits and pieces of the aircraft, and I've spoken to an accident investigator whose first impressions were absolutely stunned, and he'd never come across something quite as big as a disaster as this. I've also been up to the hill to see the cockpit area, and that, I think, is a high priority to the investigators to see if they can find anything from there.
It's very moving indeed, because there are a lot of personal possessions that you can see scattered about. Speculation is not evidence, and they are systematically obtaining the evidence and systematically searching the hills around for further people and evidence.
I suppose that statistically, something like this has got to happen at some stage on a town. It is most sad and unfortunate that it's had to happen to Lockerbie, and, of course, so close to Christmas.
The mountain rescue teams with dogs from Fleece, North and South Yorkshire, Cumbria, were the first to scour the terrain. Members of rescue teams on the site within 2 hours found Americans already there. The police and military are still prohibited by the British Official Secrets Act from speaking.
This helicopter was overflying the area, and a chap who was looking at it at me out of a telescopic sight of a rifle, which is a, you know, probably some Secret Service man or other. Yeah. It was a white unmarked helicopter, it, for all intent and purposes, a civilian helicopter. It must have had an opening door, and he sat in the doorway, just scanning the landscape with his telescopic sight on a rifle.
There was helicopters landing just even behind me here in the field. They were landing quite regular. In fact, there was an odd one landed in the a tiny wee paddock in front of the house. They were constant. They were every day. For days on end, they were flying over.
It was thought that it was very odd and strange that so many people should be involved in moving bodies, looking at luggage, who were not members of the investigating force. What were they looking for so carefully? You know, this was not just searching desperately for loved ones. It was far more than that. It was careful examination of baggage and indeed bodies.
Later on, there was some Americans. I was speaking to them on top of the hill. I was checking my sheep on the hill at the time and asked us not to go up near this wee wood on the top, because, so I just presumed they were looking for something. But I just steered clear out of the way.
I heard a story about two suitcases full of money on the other plane, but of course I didn't see any of it.
Well, the cockpit was like the head of some mortally wounded bird. It was instantly recognizable as a cockpit. And as daylight broke on the first full day of the disaster, the bodies were in an arc right round the hills that form the sort of amphitheater here. And they were well spread out. It was soft ground. A lot of them had made indentations. And even a year afterwards, the animals wouldn't graze where the bodies had landed. It was as if they knew that something very terrible and yet very sacred had happened there.
I rang up a number of times and said who I was. And eventually I established a good relationship over the telephone with one of the doctors who was doing the post-mortems. And it was he who arranged for me to see her body, I think very much counter to the instructions he'd been given. But he undertook to have the body put somewhere where I could see it, identify it. And he was extremely kind to me when I went in to see the body. One thing I wanted was a lock of hair. And again, it's one of those vivid memories. He went away and got a pair of scissors, got me a lock of hair.
There was no official announcement. The first seven bodies were released to be taken by road south to London for onward transportation to the relatives. And I'll never forget it. All of a sudden, the main street in Lockerbie was full of people. They were standing three deep on the pavements. Not a word was said. They stood quietly to bid farewell, to pay their respect to seven dead victims. And as I say, it was one of the most moving things I've ever seen in 40-odd years. It was very beautiful, and it was proper.
We got a message, I think, about 6 o'clock that night to say that the first bodies were being taken out of the town. About 8 o'clock, so if possible, could we go down the street to show respect? So there was a lot of people, I don't know, maybe 200 or 300 of the locals lined the streets, and when the first lorry came round the town hall with the bodies in it, it was really very, very upsetting to see it going away. Yes. It was nice that they were going home, but just sad that they had to go home in such circumstances.
We thank you for the love that our dead brothers and sisters poured out in their lives on earth. And we recall with faith the words of St. Paul, love does not come to an end. Father, we thank you for that indestructible love which came into our lives and will remain with us forever. Amen.
Your brother will rise again. I know that he will rise again, said Martha. Do you believe this? I do, she answered. I now believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world. Thanks be to God for his gospel.
And so for these dead that had fallen out of the sky into Scotland, a first memorial service. A winter January morning, Martha's story read in the presence of the Iron Lady. Over the motor flyaway, on the road to Loch Maben, in the village graveyard, all death is local. On the stones, there is even the street. High Street, for instance. Where a Rogerson, for instance, died. Generation buried with generation. Grandmother with grandson. Father of stillborn daughter. But there also are other deaths recorded. Here, wanderers away at war, away earning and saving, brought home, sent home from Gallipoli, killed in action, Gaza, dead of wounds, South and East Africa, Medicine Hat, province of Alberta and Calcutta. So they know that what these other dead had and owned is all that will ever be left of what they were, and that it must all be folded up and put away. ...1993... before the fifth anniversary, still on offer, a $4 million reward for terrorists. After the third anniversary, two governments had issued indictments against two Libyans. Why is a government then now paying for this newspaper advertisement? The third, the fourth, and now a fifth memorial. The governments seem to hope the memorials will go on and on and on, year after year, until all that is left is a fading memory clanging in a belfry tower.
Why has a full independent inquiry been consistently refused? Why, after 5 years, have no real answers been supplied.
Elia Stratis, Anthony Swan, Flora Swire, James Smith, Mary Smith, Geraldine Stevenson, Hannah Stevenson, John Stevenson, Rachel Stevenson, Charlotte Stinnett, Michael Stinnett, Stacy Stinnett.
Over 5 years, a very disturbing story has emerged about warnings. A well-respected international journalist, David Yallop, had interviewed Abu Nidal, who had warned him that there was going to be an attack on an American airliner. Yallop flew immediately back to London and notified the British authorities, MI6.
Abu Nidal, mastermind of the Rome and Vienna airport massacres, now trying to stop more killing.
I was in Libya to interview Gaddafi and Abu Nidal and a group of other people. I'd had a conversation with a man called Brian Crozier, who was an asset for the CIA and MI6, and I'd been asked by him to ask three or four specific questions to Nidal. Nidal had told me that he was being put under great pressure by the Syrians to reactivate against an American target. I typed up an 8-page report, which I have a copy of here, in which I talk about the pressure being put on Nidal by both Syria and Iraq at that time to resume terror tactics. And I then elaborated beyond the report, specifically with regard to the pressure from Syria and to a potential American target. I was insistent that this information, this was, by the way, given not just to Crozier, but to a senior member of MI6, by myself, that this should be shared with the CIA and should be shared with them immediately.
After that, there was a warning to the American embassy in Helsinki, frighteningly specific. A woman would carry a bomb on board an American airliner at Frankfurt heading for New York. That was circulated again through Interpol and again through the American State Department warning system.
In the build-up prior to the tragedy, there were a number of warnings that came out through the FAA and various other agencies. The particular one that was of interest to me was the Helsinki warning, which I first had knowledge of. I believe it was on the morning of the 8th of December.
We did indeed receive on December 9th an advisory based on an untested source in terms of reliability. That information was disseminated throughout this embassy, and we advised all appropriate British authorities, including all American carriers.
I'd received a telex. I was in Brussels, actually, on the morning, and I'd received a telex from headquarters that I was to go to Helsinki and that I was to get further information from my colleague in Frankfurt, who I telephoned and then subsequently came back to London and made arrangements to travel to Helsinki later that day.
It was an unidentified caller that apparently made a phone call to our embassy in Helsinki.
I got the impression from the person I was discussing it with that it had been thoroughly checked out and was considered to be a hoax.
We receive dozens of threats each day. We always take them seriously. In this case, we took action immediately.
We were notified of it. It was circulated to all the appropriate commands. To anticipate your next question, no, as far as I can determine at this point, it was not posted on bulletin boards.
Almost at the same time as I was talking to these two secret agents here in London, that a warning had come from Helsinki that talked of the bombing of a Frankfurt-bound plane, and that other warnings were even more specific and talked of Pan Am 103. And what bemused me was that all of us had, in our own way, given pieces of a very crucial puzzle to intelligence, which they'd chosen to ignore, or so it seemed. But subsequently, it became apparent to me from further inquiries that they hadn't ignored them, and that a number of VIPs were pulled off their plane, a number of intelligence operatives were pulled off that plane.
The South Africans, particularly Pick Botha, were booked on Flight 103 and changed pretty much at the last hour or so. These South Africans had been warned by Bureau of State Security to change reservations.
The South Africans booked on Flight 103 cancelled just before departure. Along with Pick Botha, General Mallon, the Defense Minister, and General Van Tonder, head of the Secret Service, BOSS, and other senior government officials. Botha, Mallon, and Van Tonder confirmed this change in travel arrangements to British businessman Tiny Rowlands. They tell him the source of the information was of the kind that could not be dismissed. Botha rebooks on the earlier Pan Am 101. General Van Tonder and two other members of BOSS cancel their trip altogether.
BOSS has close ties to two very important services, to the Israeli service and also to the American, to the Central Intelligence Agency.
Sometimes by going public, you achieve, you give undue attention to what the terrorist wants to call attention to. But if you want me to say that if we have specific information that a specific flight was going to be specifically targeted and that information had any credibility to it, then I think widespread notices should be given and people should well know that they were putting their lives at risk.
If you count them out, there had been at least 8 warnings to the Western intelligence authorities, whether they were British, American, or German. What did they need? A signed confession and a postcard?
I remember that Flora had been told that she'd be unlikely to get a seat on that flight because it was so near Christmas the plane would be full. Now, the plane was nothing like full, and Flora bought her ticket just a couple of days before she flew. Now, if that came about because the others who were to fill the plane had been warned, what does that say about the system? It says that the warning was widely known, that a lot of people had heard it, a lot of people acted on it. And it's only the mugs who weren't on the inside of this system that's supposed to protect innocent people who actually climbed on board that plane.
She got on that plane really as a lamb to the slaughter, that she walked up into that aircraft believing, as anyone should, might, that she was going to be safely transported to America.
Neuss muss leben. Others might die, but Neuss must live. There were more than warnings. In Neuss near Frankfurt, before the destruction of Pan Am 103, a bomb-making terrorist cell associated with the Syrian-backed terrorist Ahmed Jibril had been discovered. The good burghers cross over the canal. The motor barge putters through oil splotches past the gantry cranes. Here, only the water is bad. The phone booth, still there at the end of the street. Is there somebody in it? Has someone been warned? Has someone been told to run away? One terrorist cell, two terrorist cells, three terrorist cells. How long before? How long after?
On the 8th of December 1988, the anniversary of the Intifada, units of the Sayeret Golani, the Golani Brigade, the SAS of the Israeli Defense Forces, raided a PFLPGC base in southern Lebanon at a place called Al-Numia. It was an extensive base, miles of underground tunnels, underground bunkers, one of which was Ahmed Jibril's headquarters in southern Lebanon.
The group you referred to was a clandestine cell of the PFLPGC, the Ahmed Jibril group, that had been sent to Germany to set up an operation, several operations as a matter of fact, directed against both the Americans and other Western targets. That group had been set up in the aftermath of the American shootdown of the Iranian Airbus in July 1988.
Bodies float in the Persian Gulf. Iranians on a flight to Mecca, shot out of their Airbus by an American warship.
Monsieur Tehan Krim, vu de la, du côté iranien, du peuple surtout, c'était un crime. Et d'ailleurs, en réalité aussi, c'était un crime. Chasser un avion par fusée et tuer presque 300 personnes, c'est un crime. Et c'est jamais oublié de part du peuple iranien. Parce que, bon, s'il s'agissait d'un autre pays. Alors, il y aurait de poursuites, il y aurait beaucoup de bruit dans le monde. Mais concernant cet avion, ils ont l'ont chassé, après ils se sont félicités, et même ils ont décoré l'officier de Vincennes, bâtiment qui a tiré sur cet avion-là.
After the downing of the Iranian aircraft by the Vincennes, everybody expected a revenge. The Iranian had to religiously avenge what had happened. It was clear that they will teach the Americans a lesson that they can do and duplicate what the Americans have done to them. It was only a question of time where an American airline, a courier, it doesn't have to be Panam, but specifically Panam, would be downed in retaliation.
Revenge just creates additional problems, doesn't it? I mean, after all, this incident wouldn't have happened if Iran wasn't and hadn't been in the process now for a long time of attacking U.S. and other shipping in the Gulf.
We've put all the ingredients into perspective, and we realize that it has to be a terrorist network that has experience in that matter. Iran would never do it directly. They would pay $10 million to a terrorist network that knew how to go about it, and the contract was out. It was known at the time that there is a contract for $10 million to down an American airline.
The Germans received a very specific warning that Ahmed Jibril's right-hand man, Hafiz Hussein Dalkamoni, and a known bomb maker, Marwan Krisat, were heading for Germany.
Following these contacts between Jibril and the Iranians, a clandestine PFLP-GC cell was set up in Neuss, Germany, and their master bomb maker, one who had developed a lot of improvised explosive devices for Jibril in the past, was also sent to Germany to work on assembling such devices. One of the targets investigators determined in the aftermath of that group's arrest was going to be an American aircraft.
The BKA, the German criminal police, mounted a surveillance operation in Frankfurt, and in October 1988, Operation Autumn Leaves arrested 17 people. They found massive amounts of weaponry, explosives, timing devices, and most significantly, in the car that was being driven by Dalkamoni, in which Grisat was a passenger, a Toshiba bomb beat radio cassette recorder with a primed bomb inside it, designed to blow up aircraft.
Il y a beaucoup, tout le temps il est à Téhéran. Il va et vient. Alors, vous savez qu'il était aussi, il est aussi un membre de service secret syrien. Il est un officier de ce service secret syrien. C'est l'Iran qui a exigé la réalisation de cet attentat et c'est Ahmad Jibril qui l'a réalisé. Ayant toute collaboration, toutes les possibilités mis à sa disposition par les ambassades concernées.
Marwan Krisat and Hafiz Dalkamoni on October 26, 1988, after a shopping spree buying electronic components. The buying binge filmed by German secret police are in this phone booth on Hafenstrasse, where they are arrested. Earlier, the BKA had been listening to the international line as Krisat from another phone had told Damascus, "I have made some changes in the medicine. It is better and stronger." When taken to BKA headquarters, Krisat insists he be allowed to make a phone call. He does, He is released soon afterwards and flies to Jordan.
I had spoken to a reporter, a German reporter who refuses to go on camera, but who is very close to federal intelligence sources here in Germany, who assured me that Kreisat was an agent of the Jordanian service and an asset of the Central Intelligence Agency.
If you take Kreisat, for example, who was a bomb maker, who served Jibril and other terrorist networks for years, he was also reporting for years his activities to Israel, Jordan, some other countries' intelligence department.
The Germans did not believe that they had sufficient evidence directly linking him at the time. So that was an internal judicial decision within the German government. He obviously continued to be a suspect for us and for the British authorities, as well as for the German authorities, the BKA. I personally spoke to the president of the BKA, Dr. Boga, and he assured me that they were going to continue an all-out effort to identify everyone involved with this Jibril group inside of Germany.
There are times that to keep an agent who have been groomed for so many years and so much effort has been put, and even if he brings you the type of information that clearly indicates that there's a bomb going to go on board or there's a bomb going to be go off some in a public place, you must sometime let it go.
Pressure had come from Bonn, from the U.S. Embassy in Bonn, to release Kreisat.
Ahmed Jibril is reported to have said that the barometric detonator bombs were to be used on attacks on Israeli bases at the top of mountains. I don't know of any Israeli bases over 10,000 feet, and the triggers were all programmed to become active at over 10,000 feet of altitude, so they could only have been meant to attack planes.
This device can be used in a number of different ways. True, it is used to make explosions in high places, but it is possible to put this device in a car at sea level, and if this car is driven to the top of a mountain, an explosion will take place. Now, this mechanism is not only related to aeroplanes. Experts are well aware of the fact that this device could be used for many purposes.
In April 1989, 4 months after the destruction of Pan Am Clipper made of the seas, 6 months after the October arrests of Kreisat and Dalkamani, the German police raid 16 Isserstrasse in Neuss, Hassan Abbasi's. That raid will lead to the discovery of three other Kreisat manufactured bombs concealed in electronic devices, in cold storage at a veggie stand owned by Abbasi. A fourth bomb is never found, and there are rumors of a fifth. These bombs are so sophisticated, the top German bomb expert is killed trying to disarm one. The German government will never request the extradition of Marwan Kreisat. The Scottish police will never be allowed to talk to Kreisat, nor will the Scottish police ever be told the details of what Kreisat told the FBI, Supervisory Agent Tom Thurman, Special Agent Edward Marshman, when the FBI talked to him on November 12th and 13th, 1989. A journalist secretly interviews the bomb maker. To him, Kreisat confirms that he had made airplane bombs for Jibril, had been sent to Germany on a revenge mission, and that he was a secret agent. So as the aircraft that was blown apart is put back together, rivets inspected, how a jumbo jet banks demonstrated by a toy model, terrorists and bombs have already been found. Terrorists have been set free. A bomb has vanished. The finger points somewhere. Syria and Iran. That somewhere soon becomes nowhere. March 1989. Paul Channon, the British Minister of Transport, in a London club, tells five journalists that the Pan Am case has been solved. Arrests are imminent. Banner headlines in the tabloids. The next day, named as the source, the minister denies he ever talked. and soon afterwards resigns. Then American columnist Jack Anderson reports in his column on a conversation between Margaret Thatcher and George Bush. Who should they blame?
I read the Anderson column. I find it a little hard to believe that two heads of state would make a unilateral decision such as he reports, exonerating governments who are documented state sponsors of terrorism of having anything to do with the Pan Am 103 event, especially given the intelligence information, some of which I know has been corroborated, which clearly links the bombing to them.
One Sunday, David Leppard, Sunday Times ace investigator, even announces he and the Times have solved the case. A story that changes when Mr. Leppard writes a Lockerbie book.
In the middle of 1989, some 6 or 7 months after Pan Am 103 blew up, when Secretary of State Baker was in Damascus, that Baker had a meeting with the Syrian foreign minister. And that meeting, Baker said, what are you doing about the GLC group? And the foreign minister didn't quite understand his drift and said, who are you talking about? He said, the Jabril group. He said, well, what about them? He said, they're responsible for Lockerbie. What are you doing about them? He said, well, how do you know they're responsible? He said, we have the evidence, and the evidence is irrefutable. Now, that was 7 months after 270 people were murdered in Scotland. I want to know why that irrefutable evidence has never been made public. I also want to know how it's now changed dramatically to suddenly be put at Tripoli's door rather than Damascus's door.
The sea and a city trying to get to sleep. Beirut? No, there are not enough ruins. Tripoli. From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, every fleet marine knows the words to the marine hymn. Oliver North, Lieutenant Colonel, U.S. Marine Corps. His commander-in-chief, the Honorable Ronald Reagan, always and still sleeping the sleep of the just, as he had in cabinet meetings, had his three presidential obsessions, hostages, Contras, and Gaddafi. Ollie worked with Vincent Cannistraro, on a program that was meant to destroy the Gaddafi regime. Vincent Cannistraro will later head the CIA's investigation into Lockerbie. Bob Woodward, in the front pages of the Washington Post, using top secret documents leaked to him from the National Security Council, wrote about the program. Deception and disinformation.
Mr. Cannistraro and myself were the coordinators of Libya policy within the NSC and did have a direct role in coordinating the papers written by state with input from the CIA and the Department of Defense and other agencies that all had a role.
I developed the policy towards Libya. In fact, I wrote the draft paper that was later adopted by the president.
Planted stories, fabricated stories. Stories that were meant to spin the world around. Crazy Gaddafi, flaky Gaddafi, killer Gaddafi. The climax of the Vince and Ollie show was to be kept very, very quiet. It does have a name.
I worked next to Ollie for about 2 years, and he was a man that would do anything to achieve the objective he was working on. First, he considered it the most important thing in the world. And secondly, he would use any means, whether that meant lying, even to his friends, manipulating people. He would do anything to achieve the goal.
There was intelligence information which could not be absolutely confirmed that Gaddafi was indeed interested in killing President Reagan. It is true that since then, people have argued that this was a fabrication by CIA Director Casey. And of course, with Casey dead, no one can know for sure what was Casey's agenda and whether indeed this information was fabricated.
Oliver North, who was one of the principal proponents of the bombing of Tripoli in 1986, and as we understand now, did manipulate the press, talked quite freely with a lot of media people and had no compunctions about providing false information.
It is certain that Gaddafi sent people who worked for him, Libyans and others, into the United States to kill Libyan dissidents. There's no question about that. Whether some people may have twisted information that dealt with those individuals into stories alleging a conspiracy against President Reagan may be true or may not be true.
The airplanes gather in silence, even if the afterburners are at full thrust, as they always have been during every long war that waxes hot and cold. The affable ally, the lady, never keeps the gentleman waiting for long. The bombs and planes are American. The British provide only the pavement. That way, these two very special partners can again skirt the rest of Europe. Lady and gentleman, waiting. Pilot, fuse and bomb, all waiting. If the wait is too long, a pretext can always be created. In 1986, La Belle Disco in Berlin bombed. Libya is like magnetic north. The finger always points there. After the rubble settles in Berlin, Tripoli and Benghazi, the evidence implicating Libya goes up in smoke.
We were able, through technical intelligence means, in almost real time, to intercept communications between the Libyan People's Bureau in Germany, and the intelligence headquarters in Tripoli, which stated very clearly that a terrorist act had just been perpetrated against an American target, as had been directed. And as far as the United States government was concerned, this was ample proof and justification for the retaliation which ensued.
My fellow Americans, at 7 o'clock this evening, Eastern Time, air and naval forces of the United States launched a series of strikes against the headquarters, terrorist facilities, and military assets that support Muammar Gaddafi's subversive activities. The attacks were concentrated and carefully targeted to minimize casualties among the Libyan people, with whom we have no quarrel.
In the explosion later on, some Libyan take me in the car and bring me here in the hospital.
Britain was crazy. So we have about 5,000 of their nationals. Now, we have the right to kill them right now.
Perhaps they wanted to bomb and to kill just the citizens, not military camps.
I saw the effects of that bombing firsthand, and I talked to some of the relatives of people that had died. I talked to some of the people that had been injured. They were ordinary Libyan people. I went and walked around the ruins of the French embassy, the German embassy. They were very Catholic with their bombing, the Americans. If it was standing, they hit it.
The strikes that were conducted against the Azizia barracks were targeted on the Azizia barracks. And at no time am I aware of any directive or action that was taken directly by the United States that could be described as an assassination attempt. I know that some have accused the Reagan administration, and indeed some journalists have accused me personally of trying to arrange for the assassination of Gaddafi. Those accusations are false and without merit.
The only building they hit inside the Azizia barracks where Gaddafi was, which is a huge area, I mean, you're talking something like the size of St. James's Park. Only one building was hit was a two-story building, which was Gaddafi's private residence. There's no doubt in my mind it was a contract. It was a target to hit one and kill one man.
At no time did any document call for action that could be defined as an assassination attempt against the life of Colonel Gaddafi. Not that many people in the United States would have been unhappy to see Colonel Gaddafi leave the scene, but at no time did our policy direct that be a tactic or strategy that we sought to implement.
I established that Reagan, who went on American TV at 7 o'clock in the evening Eastern Standard Time to explain the attack that had just occurred at 2 o'clock in the morning over Libya, had to have his alter cue changed, because initially it was justifying the killing of Gaddafi, and of course that hadn't happened, so that had to be wiped off the alter cue.
A cluster bomb casing, the stenciled warranty where to return if defective in manufacture. Bomblets. The wing wheel of an F-11. The pile of helmets left behind as if the whooping pilots had thrown them off after a wild bucking ride. The only thing missing, because not made of metal, the 15-month-old girl that died in the ruins. Muammar Gaddafi's adopted daughter.
I have no illusion that tonight's action will ring down the curtain on Gaddafi's reign of terror. But this mission, violent though it was, can bring closer a safer and more secure world for decent men and women. We will persevere.
The policy basically was to confront the Libyans, and it did lead to military confrontation with the Libyans.
What is that famous saying about putting the fox in charge of the chicken coop? You know, for Vincent Cannistraro to be put in charge of investigating Lockerbie would be funny if it weren't an obscenity.
Vince was quite aware of what was going on in Syria. He was quite aware of the Iranian dimension and the Iraqi dimension and their role in state-sponsored terrorism. What emerged in U.S. policy was the tendency to be able to most directly deal with Libya because of Libya's geographic proximity to Europe and the United States, as opposed to Iraq, Iran, or Syria. It was much more difficult to deal with the other countries.
Cannistraro is not interested in investigating Lockerbie. I believe Cannistraro was put in charge to make sure that the Lockerbie case goes in a specific direction, because he wasn't put in charge immediately. As long as there was a, you know, as long as at the beginning they were willing to blame Syria and Iran, Cannistraro had nothing to do with Lockerbie. As soon as it shifted to Libya, then they brought in, of course, the Libyan dirty tricks expert to oversee the investigation.
The Syrian support for terrorism was much more circumspect. The Syrians were much more capable of concealing their direct role. The Iraqis had been taken off the list of countries that supported terrorism in the direction of CIA Director Casey in early 1982 in order to facilitate the U.S. tilt towards Iraq. The Iranians, because of their geographic proximity, while clearly an acknowledged sponsor of terrorism, who were very active, particularly in Lebanon, but elsewhere around the world, were also hard for the United States to reach.
I think the Scottish police did an outstanding job. Some of it has been documented. I think the FBI in particular, their explosives experts and their forensics experts also did an outstanding job. I think on both sides of the Atlantic, it was probably the largest criminal investigation in the history of both countries.
The crime scene work that was done not only in the small town of Lockerbie, but throughout almost all of southern Scotland and much of northern England, the very minute detail of collecting all the bits and pieces of evidence, the bringing together of military and civilian and law enforcement and foreign agencies as well, I think was a remarkable accomplishment on the part of the Scottish police and the English authorities that were backing them up, Scotland Yard and their military and others.
Approximately 10,000 items of baggage and other artifacts have been recovered in the widespread searches extending from Lockerbie to the Kielder Forest in Northumbria. These articles are currently being evaluated for evidential purposes. Detective officers forming part of this investigation are involved in joint inquiries with their respective colleagues in West Germany
and the United States of America.
All of the major developments in the case were provided by the criminal investigators. The principal evidence that led to an identification of a foreign role in an act of terrorism was a forensic evidence recovered by the Scots police at Lockerbie themselves. Investigators and townspeople on their hands and knees crawling along the countryside, picking up minute bits of debris. And one of those bits of debris turned out to be a microchip, which was analyzed forensically, then led to the Libyan connection.
God sometimes speaks to detectives in mysterious ways. After 2 years, sometime in those 2 years, after two Scottish winters, surviving wind, mist and snow in the 850 square miles, moor and forest land, where 150 mile headwinds had scattered wreckage, a miracle, a clue, found, they say, near the Kildare Pine Forest, where it is as dark as it must have been before time began, with a first big bang.
Some areas which were very densely forest, which we couldn't penetrate, and that area was ignored. We then got into the areas of woodland that had been thinned, where debris had both remained in the trees and dropped through to the forest floor. That was cleared wherever we could by gaining access. There was nothing cleared out of the high trees.
The criteria for finding things with burn marks and scorch marks on was to keep those items separate and hand them in as a separate item at the end of the day, so they could be specifically identified and checked out in priority to all the debris that would be sorted out at a later date. And we did in fact find one item about the size of a postcard that was a piece of material with the evidence of burn marks in a hole right through it.
We were really told to bring whatever we could back, which we would get up easily. So anything that was up in the high canopy was left. The remainder was cleared.
On the Scottish moors, the mist comes in near the ground, but in the pine woods, where the tiny bit of microchip rested until found, even the mist is invisible.
Tom and I were associates in the explosive unit. We worked together in that unit. And he was assigned the case as the case agent for the FBI, the forensic examiner, if you will. And it was Tom's responsibility to organize and collect all of this evidence, analyze it, as well as the people from RARDI, the British side of the forensic investigation, and to coordinate the results of their analysis and examination to identify these components, reconstruct the bomb, and provide these leads that were so essential.
Intrepid Tom Thurman of the FBI had, in 1989, interviewed Noise bomb maker Cresat, never sharing what he was told with the Scottish police. This time, before he could act, he had to be helped by two English counterparts, forensic experts from RARDI. The first to see the importance of the extraordinarily eventful forensic find. One, the curious doctor, Allan Feraday, who has had one terrorist case he investigated thrown out on appeal, with others under legal scrutiny.
Perhaps one of the most surprising things about Allan Feraday as an expert witness is that he has no formal academic qualifications whatsoever. The only qualification he has is a technician's qualification, I suppose you'd call it, a higher national certificate in physics and electronics, and that's about 30 years out of date. So, no, he's not a doctor, and indeed I would even go so far as to say he's not a scientist in the accepted sense. Well, the first time I encountered him giving evidence was in the trial of Daniel McNamee, an Irish person who was in the Old Bailey. He was up on bomb-making charges. I was, because of some previous court experience, I was asked to come along and to watch proceedings. I was from the public gallery, and I watched Feraday, and I gradually became aware that he was giving the evidence a certain emphasis that really wasn't justified, that technically couldn't be justified.
Thomas Hayes, the second English forensic expert, an actual real chemist, has his own terrorist associations. The Maguire Seven, associated with Jerry Conlon, convicted of needing TNT in their bathroom, in part because of Hayes' scientific evidence. The Maguire spent 63 years in prison.
The evidence was entirely forensic in nature. There was no other evidence at all. They made no confessions. In fact, they consistently denied any involvement in any terrorist activity or handling any such material. Dr. Hayes had carried out a test on gloves belonging to Mrs. Maguire on a second occasion and had detected the presence of nitroglycerin on that test. So he was not actually a primary witness. He was a secondary witness as to fact. But his role during the course of the trial as a chemist and a qualified chemist, whereas the others who were giving evidence had no formal qualifications but had worked in the field of explosives detection for many years. His role was to reinforce what was being said and to provide the explanations that the court needed in order to be able to comprehend the nature of the prosecution case against these people.
Allan Faraday maintained, wrongly in my view, that the electronics was intrinsically sinister. For example, that a tiny little board with an amplifier chip on it, I mean, in itself an utterly innocuous item, he would maintain that it was specifically designed and constructed for bomb-making purposes. And, the implication being that anyone who handled or anything, any involvement whatsoever to do with this tiny little circuit board would have knowingly been involved, had to be knowingly involved in bomb construction.
They were all saying the same thing. They were all saying that the test was specific. They were all saying that there wasn't enough sample to run a second test. They were all saying that there was no other substance known to them that could be confused with nitroglycerin. And I frankly do not believe that all of them could have been saying that if they hadn't put their heads together to say it, because all of them were saying something that they knew and must have known was a lie. The only logical explanation for the pattern of conduct in not revealing all of these things that should have been revealed, including the tests that they had secretly carried out in their laboratory in order to determine their theories, which had in fact been supportive of the defense case and not their own, is that they were engaged in a giant conspiracy, which resulted in these people being convicted.
Well, as I haven't seen the Lockerbie evidence, so I can't comment on that directly. The involvement of Allan Faraday, that worries me. Particularly my experience in the Gibraltar case, one thing that struck me then at the time, very strongly, the British government employs hundreds of people, extraordinarily well qualified in the areas of radio communication and electronics. Allan Faraday is not qualified, yet they use him. I mean, I have to ask the question, why?
Essentially, on June 15th of 1990, was the day that I made the identification. And I knew at that point what it meant. And because, if you will, I'm an investigator as well as a forensic examiner. I knew where that would go, that at that point we had no conclusive proof of the type of timing mechanism that was used in the bombing of 103. When that identification was made of the timer, I knew that we had it.
The forest find leads to Zurich, where money grows in banks, where the hand that steals is not cut off, just grows other hands. To this man, Edwin Bollier.
Und die schottische und die amerikanische FBI kamen dann in die Schweiz und man hat uns erklärt, dass solche Timer, also man hat uns dieses Fragment gezeigt auf einer großen Polizeifoto und hat gesagt, ob das von einem Timer von unserer Fertigung ist. Wir haben sofort, also ich habe sofort auf diese Foto erkannt, dass das tatsächlich ein Stück ist aus einem Timer der Nullserie, der ersten Serie von unseren MST-13-Timern. Und man hat mir dann erklärt, dass zwei von diesen Timern beschlagnahmt wurden in 1986 in Dakar. Und später, glaube ich, noch in Senegal von zwei libyschen Leuten. Und ich habe also auf der Foto eindeutig erkannt, dass dieses Fragment, was gezeigt wurde, dass das in Lockerbie gefunden wurde, dass das von einem Timer stammt, die wir gefertigt haben.
The Libyan intelligence provided Mebo with an order. They provided the specification and an order for the production of a certain number of timers that are used in explosive devices, what are called IEDs, improvised explosive devices.
Also man sagt, diese Bombe sei in einem Toshiba-Radio gewesen und also mindestens in diesem Gehäuse wäre kein Platz in diesem Radio. Wenn man es ausbaut, ich weiß es nicht, könnte sein.
A magnification of that circuit board, which is here, you see it's a very large magnification, has a partially obliterated marking. And through investigation, we determined that this actually is M-E-B-O. Initially, we thought that it might be another number, like M-580, and that was number of leads were sent out to electronic manufacturers to see if they had made this board. And they said no, that was not their identification. So the last thing that we determined, which was the right thing, actually, that it's M-E-B-O. We had some inkling that that's what it was from the beginning, but we didn't want to say, okay, that it's Mebo to the exclusion of anything else until we're absolutely certain.
Ich ging dann natürlich nach all diesen, wir hatten einen Schock bekommen, als wir gehört haben, dass so ein Fragmentstück gefunden wurde im tragischen Unfall in Lockerbie. Und ich wollte dann genau wissen, ich wollte mal dieses Teil sehen. Ich ging darum eine Woche lang nach FBI im Jahre 1990, glaube ich, oder 91, und wollte unter anderem dieses Fragment einmal in Natura sehen. Man hat mir dann gesagt, das befindet sich nicht bei Ihnen, sondern bei der Scottish Police. Ich ging also nachträglich zur Scottish Police eine Woche und auch dort hat man auf mein Verlangen hin mir das Stück nicht zu Gesicht bringen wollen, nur auf einer Foto.
The forensics determined that the microchip found in the debris at Lockerbie came from one of those timers produced by Mebo. They were able to trace it to the certain lot that Libyan intelligence had purchased from them.
Und hat mir dann erklärt, das könne mir sehr gut erklären, drei von seinen Leuten hätten unterschrieben dafür, dass sie dieses Stück gefunden hätten in einem Stück Mantel und die drei FBI-Leute hätten dafür unterschrieben. Später hörte ich, dass es hieß, die schottische Polizei hätte das Stück gefunden in einem Hemd, das aus Malta stammt.
So the FBI were telling Mr. Bollier, they had three men in Scotland in place constantly for 2 years when every piece was found. Because how could they have known beforehand what was important? Then the Scottish police tell him that none of that is true. They, in fact, found the smoking timer themselves in a shirt from Malta. 2 years after his mountain rescue team had searched the Kildare Forest for two brief but terrible Christmas weeks, that is how long the main search really went on, Bobby was asked by the police to sign a statement saying he had found things, including things he could not even identify.
Approximately 2 years after the searching finished, I received a phone call from a policeman in Lockerbie itself asking if he could come down to my home and bring with him certain bags containing some evidence that was of an important nature, and would I sign to say that I'd picked those up, or people in my party had picked those up and I'd handed them in. He brought with him three small bags about the size of an A5 piece of paper, one of which contained this item of cloth, one of which contained a brown piece which looked very much like a piece of suitcase, and the third item, I've just no idea what it was.
Then the trail blurs further. Other countries, in fact, had the same timers.
Als ich befragt wurde, habe ich mich nicht erinnert, dass wir noch zwei Stück an die DDR geliefert haben. Und zwar hat die DDR dazumal die Stelle dort, die Einkaufsstelle, hat dazumal diese Timer nicht bestellt. Sondern ich hatte die, weil wir die neu entwickelt haben bei einem Geschäftstreffen, hatte ich zwei solche Timer mitgenommen und sie auch offeriert. Und man hat dann diese zwei dort behalten und gesagt, man werde die später bezahlen.
There has been some speculation about timers from that same series being provided to Stasi. And it's true that they were, but they were on brown circuit boards. The circuit board that was used in the explosion of Lockerbie was a green production model of the timer, and that came from Libyan intelligence.
In the Stasi files, the name of Edwin Bollier, codename Ruben, Stasi agent, his control, Joachim Henschel, codename Wenzel, meetings in Berlin safe houses, German girls in the inter-hotels. The Stasi had discovered Bollier was selling everything to everyone. The timers only the Libyans were supposed to have to the Stasi, and American C4 explosives, and Italian remote radio control detonators. 2 million Deutschmarks won Stasi payment for gear. And selling directly to terrorists, the Red Army faction, Palestinians, other Arabs, in both Germanies. The Stasi even conclude Bollier must have been working for the CIA because he seemed to be able to get very special American equipment so easily for the Stasi. Double, triple, quadruple agent. A truly neutral Swiss businessman.
Through good training and through good diligence and through the tremendous amount of concentration and hard work and effort that was put out by the search team, that evidence was found. Luck was made in this case by a very strong cooperative effort among law enforcement and military services in this case. And that's what brought the successful resolution to the identification of the people involved in that bombing.
Then another twist in turncoat Zurika Bollier's story. After a visit by Americans on December 28, 1988, he signed a document 1 week after Pan Am 103 was destroyed. A document in which Mr. Bollier swears his timers were of a model only sold to Libya. Signed even before the use of a bomb had been made public. Before the miraculous groveling search, thousand Scots in lines on hands and knees find the smoking fragment. Mr. Bollier had sold so much to so many, he could be blackmailed. So in that situation, he signed. Now he says the document can belong to whomever pays him $2 million cash.
After 3 years of one of the most complex and exhaustive investigations in history, head of the inquiry, Lord Fraser, named names.
The two accused are Abdul Basit Ali Muhammad al-Magrahi and al-Amin Khalifa Fima.
That the investigation has come to this conclusion is not a surprise. We are now actively considering what actions to take.
We have no evidence to implicate another country in this disaster.
I understand the investigation has revealed no evidence to support suggestion of involvement by other countries.
In the coming days, the President will be consulting closely with Prime Minister Major and other world leaders to fashion together a cooperative international response to this latest terrorist atrocity by Gaddafi's government.
Today marks a milestone in the nearly 3 years of unresolved grief and unrelenting persistence to find the truth. Today, we call upon the political powers of all civilized nations to send a strong and unequivocal message to Libya and all states that aid, abet, harbor, sponsor, and support terrorist activities, that they will no longer be tolerated in the world community.
وجيت وصلت بذهول كبير لما سمعت اسمي والحقيقة حتى اتهام بلدي كان مفاجأة كبيرة لي وهذا خلاني أنا تعبت أنا وعائلتي بصراحة تعبت بشكل كبير
أنا لا نرى تواجدي في مالطا كانت فرصة لي بأن أقوم بعمل إرهابي مثل هذا الذي يتهموني به فعلاقاتي داخل مالطا معروفة ويمكن لأي شخص أنه هو يسأل علي
I know him I know he will never hurt a fly but it was a shock that it was put on him they put his name you know you can't believe it
I don't really believe it that he done it you know not even all the Maltese that knew him never believed that he did it
it was unbelievable I mean everybody they had the same opinion in a way they you know he's not such a person
he's so soft that they give him a nickname the egg you know that means he's very very soft
وأنا لا ليست لدي إجابة على ذلك لأنني مستغرب ماذا أريد أن أقول دولة اتهمتني باطلا أنا لا أعرف الأسباب أنا لا كنت أعرف ولا ذكرت لكم
The Roman theater in Sabarata, Libya, pocked and sandblasted. In its splendor, when Africa provided the grain for Rome and a Libyan, Septimus Severus was Roman emperor, 1500 years before the birth of the American Republic. Two Libyans, cast without ever auditioning, have now become players in a new play with a very old plot. White hats and black hats. The play goes like this. Basit Maghrabi, terrorist one, a frequent traveler in his work for Libyan Arab Airlines, always using his own passport, arrives in Malta and using a false passport, checks into the Holiday Inn, one of the only two luxury hotels in Sailima not owned by Libya.
هم يتصورون أنني أستعمل اسم مزور ولكن سوف في المحكمة سوف تكون هناك إجابة واضحة لهذا الموضوع يعني.
In the meantime, second terrorist Lamine Fima is rigging a bomb in the Libyan Arab Airlines office. Could it be this office? Or perhaps this one? Using Semtex, he has stored there amongst the Libyan, Maltese, and other employees, and of course, Mr. Bollier's device.
أنا لا 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 تدخل يعني عقلي إن نستعمل متفجرات أو نقوم بتخزينها داخل مكتب من مكاتب خطوط طيران داخل المطار.
هذا المكتب يشتغل فيه ليبيين ومالطيين. فكيف يمكن وضع مادة زي هذه خطيرة جدا في هذا المكتب وكيف يمكن السكوت عنها إذا كان راها أي حد منا
When the Great War Fleet docked in Malta, the warship tenders would unload sailors looking for what every sailor seeks at the foot of this Sailima street. Now shoppers look for other kinds of cheap deals.
What was more valuable than the suitcase and the tracing of the suitcase were the clothes in that suitcase. There were some baby clothes. There was an umbrella. There were different items that were not really consistent with having come from this one suitcase. You know, you figure a suitcase from a man who was owned by a man would have just men's clothes in there. Here was a suitcase that had several different items in there from babies to adults to casual items. It turned out that apparently, as I recall, that one of the items of clothing, not to be specific, was traced as a suitcase might have been.
Bomb-damaged clothes made in Malta had been found in the Pan Am 103 debris, so secret agent Maghrabi must have scrambled up and down the shopping street from shop to shop, finally buying baby clothes, pants in different sizes, an umbrella at Mary's house. Tony Gauci and Paul Gauci, the brother owners. Maghrabi, truly incognito, not as lucky as Dalkamani and Krisat in Noyce, had not been filmed. So over 2 years, Tony will make 18 separate statements, Paul 4 to the FBI and Scottish police,
as they try to get the brothers to identify the clothes buyer. 50 years old, 6 feet, hefty, full hair, had been there before, had been there again, had been there once, had seen him in a bar several months later. The baby clothes had a sheep's head, no, an entire lamb embroidered. I will sign, though I do not read English. 20 years older than the photo fit. Similar, but not identical. Maybe, perhaps, like him, but not fully like him. Like the man in the Sunday Times. Lamine Fima then steals Air Malta luggage tags, after duly noting the English word in his diary.
أول شيء أنا فترة الحادثة لم أكن أشتغل داخل المطار حسب ما هي الصورة واضحة أمام العالم. بالنسبة للتاجز موجودة بطاقات الشنط موجودة في المطارات بشكل لست أنا اللي الوحيد اللي ممكن نصل إليها قد يصل لها أي شخص آخر ومن السهل بل موجودة في جميع مكاتب الخطوط الليبية لماذا لا يقولوا بأن هي سرقت من داخل مكتب الخطوط الليبية في مالطا في ليبيا
And then arranges for an unaccompanied bag full of the medley of Maltese clothes and the bomb to be put unaccompanied on an Air Malta flight. The bag going through three airport security systems, traveling through a European winter with unpredictable flight delays, the explosion capable of occurring anywhere on Pan Am 103, in the air, over land or sea, even in the airport. Our play began as a tragedy. Has it now become a comedy? With two stooges, not three?
If a device had been infiltrated into the system at Malta, it would have been necessary for that device to have been carried in an aircraft on the sector from Malta to Frankfurt, to have gone through a handling process, been carried on an aircraft for the sector from Frankfurt to Heathrow, and then timed to detonate during the final sector, Heathrow to New York, presumably whilst the aircraft was over the ocean to avoid discovery, forensic evidence. And one has to say, are terrorists idiots? Don't terrorists plan to have a reasonable degree of success of doing it? We looked at something else, and it's a matter of public record, of the bomb-making activities and the group that had been active in Germany, in Neuss at the time. There's all the publicity, the documentation of that. So we had to consider, do you think it's likely that a terrorist group that has managed to manufacture a very sophisticated device in Germany, are they going to move it somewhere else and then send it on its way back to Germany?
Now, I went to Frankfurt Airport on 23rd of January 1989 to look for documents in relation to the preparation of flight 103 from Frankfurt to London, in particular the cargo and baggage loading plan, who was responsible for loading the plane and what the duties were. But these documents were missing from the daily file.
The records at Frankfurt they were by no means complete. One was not able to get hold of the detailed records. Particularly that concerned me was there was no record as to who unloaded that flight KM-180 when it arrived at Frankfurt. We don't know who the loaders were. There was no record of the number of bags that were actually unloaded from that flight. There were no records that I could find.
If the original documents had been taken by the authorities, and by that I mean the police, then it would be normal practice for a copy to be retained in the Pan Am file.
In 1993, Air Malta wins its libel suit against Granada Television. Granada, in a docudrama, had claimed the bomb had been placed in an unaccompanied bag on an Air Malta flight.
But Malta the records of the handling of that flight, KM180, were made available for me to see. There was no evidence of any unaccompanied bags. All of the bags that were carried as passenger baggage on that flight had been checked in by a passenger who actually travelled on the flight.
When, in October 1989, the FBI visited Frankfurt Airport, the agent sent back this telex to Washington. No evidence of any bag transferred from an Air Malta flight. The only evidence showing a transferred bag, a computer printout used to prepare this German police report. An airport employee, Mrs. Erak, claims to have stored in her locker a copy printed off the destroyed original computer tape.
The computer printout does not say where the bag came from. They try to tie that bag to KM180 from the worksheet, which was maintained. And as we found, the worksheet is completely unreliable. And in any case, even if you accept that the worksheet was approximately right, we have nobody that can account for or was in charge of or can tell us who or how those bags came from the actual aircraft, KM180, to that coding station. And for more than 1 kilometer, and while they were in there waiting, those bags were under nobody's control or supervision. They were not counted. We don't know how many should be there, and it would have been possible to put another bag in there along any of that route or at any time.
I've never seen any documentation whatsoever produced by Pan Am or anybody else to show there was any interline baggage from Air Malta flight on the 21st of December 1988.
What I can tell you is that both Fahima and Megrahi are members of the Libyan intelligence service. They were undercover as employees of Libyan Arab Airways, but they are in actuality members of the Libyan intelligence service.
أنا منذ صغري لم لا أنا ولا أحد من عائلتي والحمد لله أنهم دخلوا في مجال سياسي أو مجال أمني داخل الدولة الليبية ولا عمري أنا فكرت في حياتي بأن أكون يعني عملي غير المدني دائما اشتغلت في الخطوط ودائما ولا زلت ان شاء الله املي ان اشتغل في الخطوط
تميت دوره الترحيل الجوي في نيويورك وتحصلت على الاف اي لايسنس من الامريكيه لما تحصلت عليها كنت في ذلك الوقت كان عمري في ذلك الوقت أقل من العمر المصرح به إن نأخذ لايسنس أمريكية.
And in this, as in every spy story, especially in Malta, proverbial land of the double cross, there is a secret service defector, a Mr. Jaika, with lots of cash, girls, and whiskey.
The only thing I can tell you about this particular person is he was a former member of the Libyan intelligence service who has defected to the United States and he is now in the witness protection program of the Department of Justice. So he would be used in a trial of Fahima and Megrahi were the Libyan government ever to release these two for trial either in the United Kingdom or in the United States.
السيد جعكا كان يشتغل في محطة مالطا من ضمن الطاقم اللي يشتغل في محطة مالطا كان هو مسؤول الأمن والسلامة في محطة مالطا أنا الشيء الذي أعرفه عنه أنه كان الشخص مكروه من العاملين
وكل ما أستطيع أن أتحدث عليه بأنه هو شخص يعني كان سيء الأخلاق مع سواء الموظفين اللي كانوا يشتغلوا معانا سواء معاملته للركاب سواء السلطات المالطية نفسها داخل المطار تعرف الكلام هذا يعني
He used to come here with the Libyan Arab Airlines crew or the guests that the passengers that they have to stay all night over here and the way of dealing with us wasn't correct to the point once I remember I had to report him to his office here the representative of the Libyan Arab Airlines.
He used to ask a lot of money here. You know, he used to bring sometimes the crew of the Libyan Arab Airlines here, which this crew, they have some allowance, which we have the orders to issue this allowance to them. Well, as a representative, he had authorized signature for to give them the allowances, you know. And sometimes we used to hand it to him, and the crew wasn't there.
There's no doubt. I mean, if he doesn't give them to the staff, the crew, then he must have kept them.
They asked him to return back to Libya because his contract finished or he's staying in Malta. So after a few days, he came here to the hotel and he had a plaster in his hand, you know. So what's wrong? I mean, he said, oh, I just fell from the stairs, and apparently he made this to get an extension, another 3 or 4 months to stay here.
The fact that they have, in the face of UN sanctions that are fairly onerous for them, refused to release either one of them for a trial in a Western court of law indicates that they have something to be concerned about if they were to appear free of any kind of pressure from the Libyan government. So I don't think, if they haven't done it up to the present time, they certainly have no intentions of doing it in the future.
فأنا أريد أن تكون هناك محاكمة، ولكن أريدها محاكمة عادلة، محاكمة في بلد ليس هو الخصم وهو الحكم في نفس الوقت، بلد محايد يستطيع أن يأخذ كل الحقائق المطروحة ويحكم. أنا واثق من براءتي، واثق من براءة بلدي. أنا أريد الحقيقة أن تطلع، لأن أريد أن يعرف الجميع أني بريء.
هذه هي حقوق الإنسان. عندما يرغم إنسان على المثول أمام محكمة معادلة يرفض المثول أمامها. قال هذه هي حقوق الإنسان. عندما تفرض العقوبات على دولة لكي تتنازل عن حماية مواطنيها وتدوس على حقوقهم الإنسانية. قال هذه هي حقوق الإنسان. نحن لسنا أطفال. نحن لسنا سذج حتى نصدق ترهات الغرب وتصدقه الفارق الذي لا معنى له بحقوق الإنسان.
أتوقع تجيبه ضربه لأنه كحجة بموضوع الأكرم، كحجة الأكثر والأقل. نتوقع كل شيء يديروه ضد ال 86. نتوقع ماذا ما حدث في 86؟
والشعب الليبي بريء من هذه التهمة، وإحنا نرفض التسليم.
الحقيقة ما نتوقعش تسليمهم، ونعارض حتى لو أنهم هم طلبوا تسليم أنفسهم بأنفسهم.
منذ سماعي بإعلان اسمي في الإذاعات لازلت أتذكر بأن سمعتها يوم الأربعاء بالمساء. الخميس حاولت الاتصال بمركز الشرطة التابع لمنطقتي، ولكن كان ليس لديهم أي إجراءات معينة. فأنا شخصيا اللي سلمت نفسي للسلطات الليبية.
يعتقدون أن بالحصار والتهديد وبالإرهاب الرسمي يعتقدون أن الشعب الليبي سيتنازل عن إبنائه وعن قانونه الوطني وعن سيادته وعن حقه في الحرية. هذه إهانة أيها الأخوة إذا تنازلنا عن أبنائنا، إذا تنازلنا عن قانون الوطني. هذه إهانة، إهانة موجهة لنا جميعا، لآبائنا وأجدادنا الشهداء والأبطال.
Ghadames, 700 kilometers from the Libyan coastal plain, the place where we had lunch, the legend says. Two camel drivers meeting and having lunch, one to come back to where he had left something, so the place where they had lunch. Walled oasis city, rebel territory, already in Phoenician times. When in 1911 the Italian army invaded Libya, as the Libyans were pushed back after the death of Omar Mukhtar, the Libyan leader hanged by the Italians in 1931,
It was to this rock, the citadel in the desert near Ghadames, that the Libyan survivors withdrew.
To emerge, to raid the Italians, to ambush the French Foreign Legion. Then, for 4 years during World War II, the Italians and Germans, English, French and Anzacs, push each other back and forth through the great Libyan desert. Since 1911, 1 million Libyan dead piling up. Never again. There will be no surrender of sovereignty. Again, a hand, a bag, and a baggage tag, and now, a boy.
The Hawrani family tell him, we send you to Germany, and from Germany you can go to America. We give him the address where he come to Germany. In Germany, he stay here by some friend, and he fix for him what he fix in his bag, in the tape recorder. That's what we seen, is Hezbollah behind Khalid, what he done to him.
Lebanon, the Bakar, Baalbek, and on the ridge, another Israeli airstrike. The people Israel is targeting, Hezbollah. Drugs and terrorism. Hostage country.
I came to be involved with the DEA. I got involved in trafficking cannabis products and eventually was arrested and struck a secret plea agreement with the government whereby they eventually decided to send me to Lebanon, not for cannabis products, but to basically bust the largest heroin producers on the planet.
They could not eradicate the drugs in Lebanon, so they only could do two things. That is to monitor what was being produced and how it was being shipped out, and two, use DEA informants from Lebanon in drug sting operations back in the United States to set up drug buys and catch drug buyers in the U.S. And that was a big part of what they were doing. The DEA informants would fly in to Los Angeles, for example, or Detroit, and they would be loaned out to the local DEA office and used in a drug sting operation. Many times they would haul in heroin with them in a controlled delivery. Sometimes they would take in cash and act as a buyer.
The scheme involved infiltrating DEA agents from all of Western Europe into a Lebanese network.
The DEA office in Cyprus was responsible for monitoring drug activities in Lebanon. They had to do it from a distance because they were not allowed, the agents themselves were not allowed to set foot in Lebanon. So they were relying on anything and everything their informants were telling them.
And by that time, which was in the 80s, the mid-80s, the people that were in the heroin business were also involved in financing Syrian terrorism.
Lebanon is a conduit for a great deal of drugs, and the organizations that are moving it through, or at least supporting the movement through, are the violent political organizations such as the Hezbollah, the Iranian Revolutionary Guards, and now Hamas. They are directly connected with much of the drug trafficking through that area.
The heroin laboratories themselves were located in the Bekaa Valley. The major one was run by Jamil Hamia, who was a target of our investigation, and he was in the process of producing over 100 kilos on a single batch for part of a 1,000-kilo shipment. And they would obtain the opium from Diyarbakir in Turkey, transport it with the Syrians into Lebanon, and then process it. But it was a method for financing, at the first level, internal military action in Lebanon. And at the second level, as it turns out, to finance terrorist activities in Europe and abroad.
It was arranged by the DIA for me to go over and work for the DEA in this narcotics operations group, headed by Michael T. Hurley, who was the country attaché in those days. And my main responsibility was to gather intelligence in Lebanon related to opium production and trafficking and illegal ports and that kind of thing.
I only knew of Hurley's involvement as a name at that time because he was a station chief in Cyprus. But all the station chiefs in Frankfurt and in Bonn and in Amsterdam and in Paris all knew about the operation.
A controlled delivery is a delivery where a courier carries a predetermined amount of heroin through security checkpoints with the knowledge and consent of the local law enforcement people, for example, the Germans in Frankfurt, the British Customs and Excise Service in London, to pass the heroin through on the way to New York and then on to Detroit or Houston or Los Angeles.
The drug trafficking occurred, as we understood at the time, at least once or twice a week, a courier would carry a suitcase, a brown Samsonite suitcase full of drugs from Cyprus to Frankfurt. There was an arrangement in Frankfurt with a baggage handler that the suitcase would be switched. He would come in and check in with a suitcase, a similar suitcase full of clothing. It would go through the security system. It would go down the chute down to the basement, and then the one of the employees, Panam employees, the baggage handler, would switch a similar case full of drug. It would go on board. It will arrive in Kennedy or Detroit, and then it would be sold in the local market.
Well, one of the routes I was familiar with and told firsthand about was the route that went from Beirut via Cyprus to Frankfurt, to London, to Detroit, or Houston, or Los Angeles.
It was supervised and surveilled by the German authorities. They knew that it occurred. I assume that the British government was aware that this has occurred. So there was a cooperation between three governments to monitor this activity. It's the German, the British, and the American government.
This 1986 Drug Enforcement Agency document, a meeting between Marty Maguire, Frankfurt resident DEA agent, and Mike Hurley, Cyprus resident agent. Already, all the key words, the Bakar, heroin, Syria, Cyprus, Frankfurt.
While this was going on, one has to remember that there were several hostages that were kept in Lebanon of many nationalities, and there was a strong effort to release them by negotiations, which haven't worked out. At one point, the U.S. government entertained, the military entertained a possibility of releasing those hostages by force.
But after the CIA station was blown in Lebanon, there was a mutual effort on the part of several agencies to sort of pick up the pieces, and at that particular time, DEA informants were also, the information they were coming out with was being passed on to the CIA station in Cyprus. So progressively, DEA informants were being used as assets for the CIA. So in essence, DEA informant was a cover for a CIA operation.
The old American embassy in Cyprus in the process of demolition. The great eagle seal torn from the wall, its miles of communication cables ripped out. Debris falling past Mike Hurley's ground floor office, as if even here a trail had to be destroyed. DEA Chief Mike Hurley would receive intelligence about the terrorist drug networks. That would go to the CIA. The CIA controlled the special action group operating out of this apartment building in Wiesbaden, Germany. Operational intelligence to a group in Beirut. Matthew Gannon, CIA Chief of Station, and Army Major Chuck McKee trying to locate and rescue American hostages being taken in and out of the Bakar.
A lot of attempts have been made to release those hostages by contacting known figures in the terrorist work, drug dealers and known terrorist as Monza Al-Qassar, who is related to the Syrian government by marriage, who lived and operated in both Damascus and Europe, and has had experience in trafficking not only weapons all over the world, but also drugs. They have assigned that mission to Monza Alcazar. He helped gathering the drugs in the Becca Valley and helping the drugs going into the United States. He was an asset of the CIA.
I only knew him as Muhammad, Abu Muhammad. He was the person that had to facilitate the delivery of, there was a brown substance that's a precursor to heroin. They call it base or base. I think it's base. And that's what, it's coffee colored and it comes in like gunny sacks. And he's the person that I met who facilitated the heroin across the Syrian border in the northern, the city of Ka in QAA in northern Lebanon.
Mansour al-Qassar is probably the most notorious, in the 80s anyway, gun and arms and drug supplier in the Middle East. Nothing went down in the Bekaa Valley related to narcotics, for example, without the explicit approval of Rifat Assad and Mansour al-Qassar. Nothing happened in the Bekaa Valley. Not the hostages, not the opium trade, not the heroin laboratories, not the cocaine processing labs. None of that could have happened without the express consent and involvement of Rifat Assad and the Pink Panther Brigade and his partner Mansour al-Qassar. And the Americans knew that.
Payments made to Mansour al-Qassar by Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North. The account numbers and amounts. As new recruits are sworn in for the ongoing war, the guest of honor at the Hezbollah table of dignitaries, Ahmed Jibril. Jibril, who had airplane bombs in a terrorist cell in Frankfurt in October 1988.
When Jibril realized that that operation was going on because he was participating in drug shipments and raising money through drug monitoring, so it was known, the players on the ground were known. He realized, very simple, that if he can gain access to one of the suitcases, those controlled monitored suitcases, and put a bomb into it, the bomb would be put on plane, would be supervised by those who are supervising it, including all the law enforcement agencies that are making sure that nobody challenges us, the suitcase, nobody opens it, it goes through the security system, and all he has to do is just put it in that suitcase, and the rest is history.
خالد ولد لا بيعرف بالمخدرات ولا بيعرف بالأنبلي ولا بيعرف بشيء. جبر خالد يسافر على ألمانيا مطرح ما دبر له محمد جعفر, دبر له اللي هو المسؤول بحزب الله, مسؤول عن تلة الكيال, دبر له القصة كلها سوا. قال له أنا بوديك لعند ربعي الفلسطيني تبع أحمد جبريل وغيره, بيساعدوك بألمانيا وبتجيب مصاري وبساعتها بعطيك أختي. وضحك على الولد خالد, ما هو لا بيعرف بالمخدرات ولا بالأنبلي ولا بيستعمل سلاح, ولا كانت العيلة كلها بتعرف تقوس, هو ما بيعرف يأذي نملة.
I met Mustafa in 1974. I went to his home in Baalbek, actually in Shrauni, where the Jaffer clan lives. And they have two homes, one in Shrauni, one in Hermel, in central Baalbek, in central Lebanon, in the Bekaa Valley. And I got to know a great deal about his family. This was in the pre-terrorist days, really.
The Jaffar family seat. The bullet holes from Hezbollah. The shrine inside to Khalid. Grandfather Mustafa Jafar. Khalid was his favorite grandson.
ابني أغلب من ابني مثل بعضها ما قال لي رايح على أمريكا من أمريكا هواي وهناك ما بعرف أعمل له فيزا أعمل له وبعد فعل من ألمانيا على أمريكا
خالد هم اللي قبل ما يطلع على الطيارة بيجي محمد الحوراني بيلحقه على المطار بيقول له خذ هالهدية مسجلة. أعطاه المسجلة كان فيها 2 كيلو هوريين وإجا وطلع على ألمانيا لقوا أشخاص بألمانيا أخذوا المسجلة منه واختفوا لمدة يوم رجعوا لعنده لعند خالد وأخذوهم طارح كتير وكان يتصل ببيو بجده وعطول خالد وجده يجي يشرب قهوة مع والدي كل يوم ويحكي له شو صار مع خالد.
This was a control bag going through. It wouldn't go through passport control. It wouldn't go through customs. It would just be passed through. It would be either carried through by the informant or by somebody who was a part of the local police constabulary.
I received a telephone call from somebody I knew in British Customs advising me to, or suggesting that we look at the possibility that a bag may have been switched at Frankfurt Airport by the Turkish workers because of known drug operations being run through Frankfurt Airport.
An HM Customs officer involved in the investigation of narcotics had left a message for me, and I subsequently contacted him, and I met with him, and he advised me that he'd been in Frankfurt at a meeting of drug enforcement agencies from Germany, America, and Britain, and that it was well known and discussed at that meeting that Pan Am, as an airline, was being used as a drug conduit.
To my knowledge, Pan Am had not been informed of any controlled drug shipments. And during my service with Pan Am at Heathrow, I was not notified of any drug shipments, and it would have been a requirement under the FAA regulations and the DOT regulations for us to be notified if some outside agency was putting baggage onto our aircraft.
I certainly didn't know, and I know nobody else in the Pan-American organization that I'd been in contact with was aware of it.
Although I've not handled any drug shipments, I would assume that it would be normal procedures or practice to bypass the passenger searching stage and take the bag through other routes and take direct to the aircraft, thereby avoiding possible searches to prevent unauthorized people knowing what was being shipped.
I was aware of some information with regards to the possibility that passengers on board the 103 could have been involved in the illegal movement of narcotics. And some names were mentioned to me, particularly one passenger by the name of Jafar.
When I was working in Cyprus in 1988 at DEA, we were working in a penthouse apartment on top of a building down the road from the American Embassy. We answered the phone, Urami Trading Company, which was a cutout proprietary company used by the CIA and the DEA for various and sundry purposes. One was these drug informants would come in on the sunny boat from Juni. The Cypriot police narcotics people would bring them up to the apartment. They would all sit around in the living room and drinking coffee and chatting away while I was over in my computer working away. And then they would be called up one by one on the telephone to go over and meet with Hurley at the American Embassy. And one of the people that I observed there was this kid that we used to call, that was referred to as Nazi, Nazi Jafar. Well, I knew from the conversations around me in 88 that he was involved in controlled deliveries. And there's no doubt in my mind about that at all. So when I found out he was on 103 and he was killed, and that there was a controlled delivery going through at the time, and the fact that I knew the security problems that the DEA had and the relationships that they were having with some people in Lebanon that we had already raised as an issue as far as security is concerned, it was very simple for me to put one and one together and get the big two that the DEA's operation had a role in all of this.
In 1990, before a congressional committee, the Drug Enforcement Agency, Stephen Green, acting administrator, will deny under oath
that there were any controlled drug deliveries through Frankfurt Airport in 1988. But in Virginia court documents, deliveries are documented. A DEA agent has testified being at Frankfurt Airport in 1989. The drug traffic was so heavy by then that there was a full-time DEA liaison agent, Thomas Slivenkey, at the airport. One convicted Lebanese Bakar dealer had even tried to contact a Pan Am pilot. But Frankfurt had been used as a base for covert drug and CIA operations long before.
In 1984, I was undercover, and my base of operations was in Würzburg at the headquarters of the 3rd Infantry Division. And I was contacted by a fellow who worked for Oliver North. I was asked to develop an operation, laying a trail which would lead back to Libya and make it look as though a Libyan effort was behind this to bring drugs into the United States. The way to do this is to make it look as though the material had been shipped from Europe to Libya and then from Libya to the United States. I was buying a precursor for the manufacture of speed and methylbenzyl ketone, which has the same chemical formula as cinnamic acid, which is something harmless that they put into toothpaste as flavoring. I'd buy that, and the labels would be switched, and the cinnamic acid would be shipped to Libya. Methyl benzyl ketone would be shipped into the United States to the mafia, who were paying for it in advance. My instructions were to use Frankfurt, since that was where all the contacts were. I was told to play the role of Muhammad El-Huama, who was a low-level operative in the Libyan service, and if a purchase order or something were needed, I had been provided from headquarters with stationery. I have a sample of the stationery that was used. This is the bill of lading. Libyan Airlines was to be used, and this is the bill of lading for Libyan Airlines showing that this material is going to Libya. And I received, for instance, the funds to do this through the military banking system. This one in Würzburg is a voucher for the receipt of 317,100 German marks. The street value of the drugs that I imported was about $350 million.
Khalid Jafar arrives in Germany with the 2 kilos of heroin given to him by Hezbollah captain Mohammed Jafar. A controlled delivery. No police or customs inspection. The policeman who waits for Khalid as he arrives in Germany will assist him through Frankfurt Airport security when he boards flight 103 on December 21st. Jafar takes a taxi to meet some of the people whose names have been given to him by Hezbollah. Among them, Faisal Jalous and Adnan Yunus.
Jafar was clearly working as a courier for the DEA, for the entity that has employed him to courier the drugs, the controlled substances, to the United States. He was also under strict surveillance by Mossad and by many other governments who were interested to know what is going on in that area, and who saw in advance, way in advance, that this could create a major problem in the future.
At the beginning of July 1989, our sales director in Oslo, Mrs. Berit Sosland, received some documentation and information from the local police regarding a possible meeting, or a definite meeting, by person called Goldberg and a man called Jafar somewhere in Scandinavia. And Mr. Goldberg had supplied details from his personal notebook and some handwritten notes, which had been forwarded to the local police and then to us in London. On receipt of the information, we notified the American Embassy, Mr. Bob Mahoney, and at his request, on the 7th of July, 1989, the documents were forwarded to him at the US Embassy in London, at which point we were told or advised that he would look into the matter. I've never had any telephone conversation or any written information from the US Embassy advising us the outcome of their inquiries.
In October 1988, the German Federal Police had watched a white Volvo with Swedish plates load up in front of 16 Isserstrasse in Neuss. Bomb maker Krisat had stayed there. A raid on Abbasi's apartment at that address in April 1989, after Pan Am 103 had been blown out of the sky, had led to the discovery of three Krisat bombs in electronic devices, with a fourth and possibly a fifth airplane bomb missing. Two men are driven in the Volvo to Uppsala, Sweden. The route by car ferry because of the laxer border controls. In December, before he boards Pan Am 103 in Frankfurt, Khalid Jafar is driven to Sweden by Faisal Jalous, stopping at this address in Elmshorn near Hamburg. Jafar takes the Kiel-Gothenburg ferry. One of the addresses in Goldberg's notes, 3A Storgatan, in fact, Storkgatan in Gothenburg.
A perfect address for a safe house. Two separate entrances onto two separate streets. A tramway, the highway nearby, the present occupant, Mohammed Berbouk.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello? ممكن أكلم الأستاذ محمد لو سمحت؟
نعم تفضلي.
أيوة يا أستاذ محمد، أنا كنت عايز أسألك سؤال لو سمحت، تعرف واحد اسمه خالد جعفر؟
هو أنت مين؟ أنا ما بعرف حضرتك، مين أنت؟
أيوة بس بس أنا كنت عايز أسأل حضرتك السؤال، أنا بدور عليه.
إيه بس أنا أجاوبك على سؤالك إلا تقولي أنت مين حضرتك؟
طيب وتعرف واحد اسمه سعيد علي جعفر؟
لا تسأليني كده ولا كده، أنت بتتصلي مين وأنت مين وأنا بجاوبك على السؤال.
طيب ماشي، احنا هكلمك كمان شوية.
لا لا احكي لسه، ليش تكلميني شوية؟
طب أنت مش عايز تجاوب على السؤال ليه؟
ما بجاوب طبعا، لأنه ما بعرف أنت مين حضرتك.
أي بس أنت تعرف الشخص ده ولا ما تعرفوش؟
ما بجاوب،
آسف
جدا عليه. ما بجاوب. ما بجاوب،
طبعا. طيب ماشي. طب حضرتك ساكن من هنا من زمان؟ آسف
جدا، مع السلامة.
مع السلامة. مع
السلامة. مع السلامة.
مع السلامة. مع السلامة. مع السلامة.
ألو؟
ألو، مساء الخير.
مساء النور.
الأستاذ محمد؟
نعم، اتفضلي.
كنا عارفين إن خالد جعفر كان راكب على الطيارة من اللي هي انفجرت في لوكربي كده، وإن هو عدى على السويد على السويد وكده، فده عشان كده يعني كنت بسألك، فهل أنت تعرفه فعلا أو سمعت عنه أو كده؟
أنت مين حضرتك؟ أنا قبل شوية كنت بتعشى.
أي.
وكانت المكالمة جدا مفاجئة
لي. أي.
استغربت كثير، فلذلك تنفرت لأنه ما بحب
واحد يتصل
بدون موعد.
التليفون من غير موعد كمان؟
طبعا.
يعني ما ازاي الواحد ياخد ميعاد من التليفون اذا كان لازم يتصل الاول عشان ياخد ميعاد، مش كده ولا ايه؟
لا فما هذا القصد، بس كانت مفاجئة جدا.
حضرتك عندك يعني ممكن ترد عليا في الموضوع ده ولا لا؟
Jafar will go to Stockholm, according to Mr. Goldberg, on the 1710 train on December 19th. Mr. Goldberg, after a single furtive January 1989 meeting with the Pan Am sales agent in Oslo, leaves his precise notes behind and vanishes. Goldberg, such a common Jewish name, is in fact an Israeli intelligence operative still on active duty today. Khalid tells his family in the Bakar that he had met this man, Abu Taub, during his trip to Sweden. Taub had been arrested in Uppsala in October 1988, at the same time the Jibril group arrests had been made in Neuss, Germany. Taub also was initially released, then rearrested, after Lockerbie, accused of terrorism, convicted on the flimsiest evidence, and is now serving time in Kumla prison in Sweden. In October 1988, Abu Taub had visited Cyprus and Malta. He returned from Malta with a hodgepodge of Maltese clothes. At one point, the Maltese shopkeeper, Tony Gauci, so relentlessly questioned by the FBI and Scottish police, shown Abu Taub's photograph, says Abu Taub could be the clothes buyer. But Tony is never one to make definitive statements. But Khalid Jafar does tell his family in the Bakar that he had been given Maltese clothes by Abu Taub, including a baby grow. A fragment of a baby grow, one of the items of clothing the Scottish police and FBI inquire about in Malta.
هو بس راح على مالطا مرة واحدة يعني أنا بأكتوبر بتهيألي بأكتوبر كان المشوار لأنه هو صاحب لإله بقبرص وبمالطا عنده معمل يعني تياب هونيك فقال له تعال من هونيك إذا بدك تاخد تياب رخيصة وشغلات كتير رخيصة هونيك إذا بتحب تيجي تتفرج على تياب وتاخد عأساس تصير تشحن للسويد يعني ملابس لهونيك فهو راح هاي المرة وقعد شي أربعة أيام يعني بس بمالطا وطلع منها على إجعة السويد وجايب معه طبعا شوية ألبس يعني مثل بنطلون جينز وكنزات نسائية وقمصان رجالية وهيك ف
Khalid's ticket to Detroit one way will be bought for him at Ali Reisbüro in Iserlohn, Germany. Mr. Jadala, owner of Ali's travel, confirmed a Mr. Yunus bought the ticket. Mr. Jadala was told not to reveal the name. A second call. The wife answering this time.
Yeah, Herr Jadala, bitte. Er ist nicht da. Morgen ist im Betrieb.
The official London Metropolitan Police notes on Khalid Jafar's ticket. Form of payment not known. Student ticket, one way, originating office, Pan Am, Hamburg. History of booking, none. The copy for the actual ticket held for all Pan Am passengers has, in Jafar's case, disappeared.
الو صباح الخير ممكن اكلم الاستاذ عدنان يونس لو سمحت
يا حضرتك
انا كنت عايزه حضرتك سؤال عن خالد جعفر
مين حضرتك والله
انا كنت بس عايزك ترد عليا جواب يعني صريح كده حضرتك تعرف خالد جعفر وحضرتك اللي اشتريت له التذكره
حضرتك والله مين شو اسم حضرتك
في حد اتكلم عنك باعتبارك انك كنت في منظمه احمد جبريل وانا كنت مسؤول تجنيد في منظمة احمد جبريل في اوروبا انه يقال ارضا ان حضرتك اللي اشتريت تذكرة من تذاكر الطيران او تذكرة لخالد جعفر وطبعا في كلام ان خالد جعفر هو مش عارف اذا كان حضرتك موافق على ده ولا لا ان هو اللي حط القنبلة على الطيران
لا بس حضرتكم كنت في المانيا
طب تعرف حضرتك العنوان بتاع فيصل جلوس اللي هو الصالون العربيات اللي في برلين فيصل جلوس
نعم
تعرفه موجود لسه موجود ولا لا
فيصل جلوس
فيصل جلوس ما يقال انه كان له علاقه بالموضوع برضه
فيصل جلوس كان له علاقه بالموضوع استحيل طبعا على التليفون نحكي معكم باي موضوع من هذا القبيل لان الموضوع طبعا بعرف انه انا كنت متهم فيه وطبعا مش متهم بلوكربي ولا بس انا بفضل حضرتكم
تكونوا في المانيا عدنان يونس نمره من نمر حزب الله اللي مانن المانن مليح هو بيشتغل على الجهتين هو على طول بيشتغل للسي اي اي وبيشتغل لهم هني مخابرات على الوجهين
The European night covering all Jalous still in Berlin. Did he drive Jafar to Sweden? Berbuk, did he meet Jafar? Yunus, did he buy the ticket? Will they ever be asked what they know? Major Chuck McKee, head of the hostage rescue team, takes the Sunny Boat, the Juno ferry from Lebanon to Cyprus. Matthew Gannon, Beirut CIA station chief, travels separately, arriving on a helicopter with the U.S. ambassador to Lebanon, John McCarthy. The ambassador, like Gannon, is booked on Pan Am 103, December 21st. The diplomat, however, decides not to travel into New York.
McKee has never contacted his mother or anybody while he was on missions abroad. Never, ever, anybody knew where they were. In that single occasion, upon his return, or just before he returned to the United States, he contacted his mother, and he indirectly have related to her that he's on his way back. It's unusual that he's in distress.
McKee's behavior before returning to the United States is strange. He is initially booked on Pan Am 103, December 22nd, changing to Pan Am 103, December 21st. His communications man from Beirut, through a secure link, had sent the travel details to McKee's operational control. This same member of McKee's Special Forces unit has confirmed that McKee hated drugs and had fired his Beirut driver before leaving Lebanon when he'd caught him with drugs. After McKee's death, there are stories that members of the hostage rescue team, among them McKee, had been very upset when they discovered that the agents they were asked to work with were drug dealers. There are suggestions that McKee was on his way home to expose the drugs for intelligence operation. The Drug Enforcement Agency are watching McKee. Mike Hurley separately telexes McKee's final travel arrangements to the CIA Directorate of Operations in Washington, to MI6, the British Secret Service, and to SPAG, the CIA Special Action Group in Germany, in overall control of the drugs intelligence operation. Every spook there is will know that McKee is flying back on December 21st.
Yeah, you there?
Yeah.
How are you?
I'm doing pretty good. Where are you calling from?
Well, I'm in Wiesbaden. I just got into Frankfurt to the airport, and I'm going to just chill out here for the night.
Are you alone?
Well, of course I'm alone. You don't think I'd be asking you questions with somebody around?
Hold on, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
Okay, the duty officer just came in.
Yeah. All right, now tell me where you work.
Okay.
What's that?
I just turned it off. It was being taped. What the fuck do you want to know this for, man? You mean a special action group in Wiesbaden?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, you're retired from there now, but you're still doing, what, consulting work, right?
Well, sure.
All right, now look, does the name Khalid Jafar mean anything to you?
Yeah.
Who is that?
He's a local guy, man. You know who he is.
What do you mean, local guy?
Come on.
What does he have to do with?
Mr. Lockerbie, man.
Okay. That's what Now, when he came to Germany in 88, who met him? Who met him at the plane?
You mean that prick Lovejoy?
Did? No shit.
Well, you know this.
Is he part of the structures? Is he still...
What the fuck, man? Come on, you know the shit.
Is he still part of the structures?
Yeah.
All right, that's, you know, because nobody's been able to locate him. And a lot of people have been looking for him, so you guys must be hiding him somewhere.
Yeah, that too.
All right.
Okay.
Now, when he was taken back to get on a to get on a plane to leave the country? Who took him through security?
Well, we did. Some of my fellows took him out there. We took him on the plane and turned him over to Gannon.
You mean Gannon was his keeper on the plane?
That's right.
No shit.
That's right. First class, that big motherfucker sitting right up there.
هو مو عارف في مخدرات ولا بيشتغل بالمخدرات هم اللي ضحكوا عليه حملوه مخدرات فضل مخدرات بألمانيا وحطوا له القنبله بألمانيا ومين بيروح بيموت لو عارف حاله رايح يموت ما بيعمل هيك
Mr. Key I remember because he asked me for an upgrade and he had a certificate and that was the program that we were running at that time and so I moved his class And he was over the moon about it. He was just so pleased, and we sort of struck up quite a rapport in that short period of time. And then later, another gentleman came in who I found out was Mr. Gannon. And after that, two other gentlemen came in, and they were Mr. O'Connor and Mr. Larivière. Just from observation, it was obvious that they were traveling together. They greeted each other with hugs and were much relieved when the last member arrived. But I was told by a colleague who checked them in downstairs that who had actually asked me if I would mind having them in the club that she had assumed that they were traveling together. And therefore asked if they wanted to sit together. And they had denied that they were actually traveling together. They didn't know each other. And there was a few giggles and things. And she was amazed by their attitude, but just thought they were playing around.
Special Forces Major Chuck McKee's hostage rescue mission becomes a suicide mission. The moment he boards Pan Am 103 from the Clipper Lounge.
In the fields near Tundergarth Church, there were a number of bodies in the bogs, in the woods, and around the fields. I remember particularly the Dixit family. I remember McKee, LaRivière, and a few other names, all of which I learned later on when I went to assist the police with their inquiries to identify where I'd found who.
The arc goes right round the crest of the hills, overlooking where the cockpit fell. There were a number of bodies which subsequently became of great interest to a lot of people. Charles McKee, a very brave man, an expert in counter-terrorism, was found just up on the ridge there. Gannon, Matthew Gannon, an intelligence officer. Ronald LaRivière, another intelligence officer. Captain Curry, Special Forces, who, according to his memorial, was killed in the line of duty. We've never found out exactly what that duty was. There were saints and there were sinners on that aircraft. There were also some very strange people whose backgrounds have never really been clarified.
In particular, in the Tundergarth area near the church, I identified several bodies, amongst which were those of McKee and LaRivière. I knew that McKee was absolutely correct because of the clothing which correlated closely with other reports and statements when we examined matters later on the computers which were linked to London and Washington. So far as LaRivière was concerned, he was in an area where there were only two or three people and his details correlated well with those on the computer.
At the time, I didn't know their names. I wasn't very sure exactly who they were working for, but subsequently, of course, it turned out to be Major Charles McKee from the Defence Intelligence Agency, and Ron LaRivière, and Matthew Gannon, and several other people that had loose connections with the intelligence side of things.
It's very strange. Considering some of them were travelling together, at least one of the bodies, who should have been found in a location beside his colleagues, was found, in fact, in a totally different location beside or very close to the body of a person who's been the subject of intense investigation and speculation. One is forced to wonder what somebody from the front of the plane was doing landing beside somebody who was in the second last row of seats in the aircraft.
Khalid Jafar in seat 53K at the very rear of the aircraft. Matthew Gannon in first class near where the bomb exploded. Their bodies are found 100 yards from each other, the only passengers from opposite ends of the aircraft to be thus joined in death.
Well, I was told early on that the bomb had, that the investigators believed the bomb had been taken onto the plane by a US officer who seconded to military intelligence, and the bomb had been planted on him in Beirut. Later on, when I started doing the research into Lockerbie, it was puzzling me that the line was that there weren't any drugs on the aeroplane, because it would seem that must be the first transatlantic flight for a long time not to have any drugs on it. And just asking around people who'd been involved in the investigation afterwards and involved removing the bodies from the hillside, they were able to tell me specific passengers and what they had on them. And one officer also told me how he had to get a farmer passing with a tractor and trailer to help him take his suitcase full of what he presumed to be heroin away from Tundergarth and down to the Dexstar factory where the luggage was being stored once it was recovered from the area around.
The farmer, Jim Wilson, lives in the farm facing Tundergarth Church. Still traumatized by all the death in his fields and by the past treatment by the press, he refuses to talk. Private Eye, however, had published an account. That terrible December, as bodies were still being found, Wilson told Pan Am 103 relatives, they too will not appear publicly, that he was there when the drugs were found. How soon after the police found the drugs, Americans rushed to the scene in an all-terrain vehicle and took the stash away. The Americans were very angry that the drugs had not been found sooner. A Scottish policeman, bound by official secrets and the draconian Scottish Police Disciplinary Act, and therefore not able to speak, has confirmed that there were drugs found near Tundergarth. The police were told to keep an eye out for drugs, and Khalid Jafar's name had been repeatedly mentioned as a drug courier. A mountain rescue man has separately confirmed the finding of drugs. He had been warned not to ever say anything.
The story was broadcast at 8 o'clock in the morning. By 9 o'clock, two senior policemen had arrived at my office unannounced. They knew I'd written the story despite the fact that it wasn't my voice on it, and proceeded to ask me questions over a period of about 6 hours, including the rather bizarre offer to take me to Mrs. Thatcher, who was then the Prime Minister at the time, to reveal the source of the story to her if I felt I couldn't reveal it to anyone else. Such was the importance they'd placed on finding out who'd told me this information.
Near the Kildare Forest, another secret find. This one never made public by police, FBI, or secret services.
The t-shirt that we found was had a logo on a, just a plain white t-shirt, which we understand is something to do with a Free Palestine Liberation Group. The police did come down separate to the time we were up in Belgium, actually to my home, to take a statement about the location of the article, where it was found, its grid reference, who had found it. And at the time that the police were down, they mentioned it was part of the Hezbollah group.
Daily Express, December 31st, 1988, 10 days after the bomb brought down Pan Am 103. The cover photo, Khalid Jafar. The sources for the headline, the FBI and Scotland Yard.
In the early months of 1989, I was contacted by Mustafa Jaffer after quite a long period. And he was contacting me, and he was quite excited about some information. And eventually it became clear over a number of conversations that involved the downing of Pan Am Flight 103 over Lockerbie. And the information was significant enough that he gave me, which is documented in letters that I've shown you, that I contacted my congressman, Larry Smith, and also notified the president, because it was obviously a crime that was unsolved, and this person said they had information. Mustafa Jaffer said that a relative of his had perished on the flight carrying a suitcase bound for Detroit which undoubtedly contained drugs. The information was extremely specific, and that they had someone within the organization that had put the bomb on board that could give them some indications of where future terrorist attacks were going to begin. Over the course of many calls and being in direct contact with the FBI and a number of other people, the State Department, every normal channel and authority became quite clear that he had significant information and, in fact, had predictive information in terms of the attacks on the World Trade Center, which was one of several attacks which he had said were going to be staged at that time. And this was well in advance of those attacks.
When you think of the painstaking investigation, the minute details that had to be dealt with, and when you think of the actual challenge to begin with, you had over 270 people killed, 11 on the ground, the remainder in the aircraft itself. Every one of those people, excluding the people, the citizens of Lockerbie, had to be investigated for possible connection to the terrorist event itself. Several of the investigators, as well as some of the British intelligence people involved in the investigation, were highly honored by the United Kingdom's government.
أبسط العبارة أن ابني في يوم من الأيام وجه لي سؤال يقول لي إذا قتلوك الأمريكان هل سوف يقتلوني أنا؟ هذا أبسط تعبير ومأساة أنا حاليا أواجهها أمام عائلتي.
All of us working on the case made it a very, very personal priority of the utmost order. We were not going to let this go unpunished. And frankly, I believe that we need to do more to punish Libya than we have done if they do not surrender the defendants and stand before the court of law.
وانا اندهش جدا وتعبت حتى نفسيا واهلي تعبوا جوزتي تعبت كثير وكانت حامل لما تم الاتهام وتعبت وجاها مرض للان تعاني منه يعني انا تعبت جدا انا وعائلتي واستغربت جدا وانا بقدر ما اتاسف للعائلات العائلات الضحايا انا نفسي ضحيه للاتهام وانا اقول لهم بكل صدق اني انا ضحيه لهذا الاتهام كما هم ضحايا للعمل الاجرامي اللي صار لنا.
Lester Colvin, now a political refugee, indicted by the government of the United States for perjury, so doubt would be cast on what he might reveal about the Lebanese drugs intelligence operation.
I took my family and went to Sweden. And when we got to Sweden, we went to the police station in this town where we were going to live, and we reported in, and I told them our story and asked for political asylum, and they put us up in a refugee camp, and they gave us an apartment and a living stipend, clothes, because we didn't have anything at that point, no money. It was an easy thing for us to leave. And we were looking over our shoulder the whole time until we got to Sweden. And it was such a relief, such a big burden off of our shoulders when we got there that we all just broke down in the police station. And
كان شعورنا عند موت خالد حزن لأنه ولد بريء طفل بريء حزب الله جروا لهالفيلم.
أنا أعتقد أن لجنة التحقيق الأمريكية البريطانية منذ أسابيع أخرجت تحقيقها وتقول فيه أن الجبهة القيادي العامة وأحمد جبريل ليس له أي علاقة في تفجير طائرة بان أمريكا. وأعتقد أن هذا الخبر نشر في العديد من الأماكن في هذا العالم، هنا بالمناسبة أنا أتساءل كيف يحق للإدارة الأمريكية والحكومة الأمريكية أن تتهمنا بهذا بشكل وبهذا الظلم وبشكل متسرع. والآن تأتي بعد سنوات لتبرئنا من هذا الأمر. ألا تشعر الحكومة الأمريكية بالخجل؟
In some countries they change presidents. In some countries the president stays the same. President Assad of Syria still runs the Bakar, is still paymaster to Ahmed Jibril, still protects and uses Hezbollah. Another memorial, another president, the chief constable from Scotland, some of the American Pan Am families, a monument in Arlington National Cemetery where war heroes are buried.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes today's ceremony. Please remain seated until the official party has departed. Thank you for your attendance and enjoy your day.
My son was in the army stationed in Germany and was due to come back to the United States on that particular flight. I can't say what that would have done, but it gave me an opportunity, I think, to even more personally identify with the parents and relatives of the victims and to empathize with what they must be going through and what they must have felt.
FBI chief investigator into the Lockerbie crash, Buck Revell's son, was not the last lucky passenger to miss flying on Pan Am 103. Stephen Green, acting administrator of the DEA, also had a reservation on the flight. Green has described being on the Heathrow tarmac watching the doomed plane take off.
There seems to be somewhere in the world some organization which classifies people as either important or unimportant. And Flora was important. Flora was a superb person, a lovely girl, one who had made so much contribution to the welfare and happiness of the human race through her medicine and in so many other ways. And she is just as important as any diplomat or politician or anybody else you care to name.
I think there are a thousand reasons why we brought her here. My family's been deeply attached to this island for generations. You can see the names on the stones. And Flora herself loved the island very much when she was a little girl. This was where we always came for holidays, and therefore it was a joyful place for her to come. And the natural beauty of the place, it certainly affects me very much, and it affected her very much too, I think. And she loves the sound of the sea and the wildness of the place. Well, Flora, of course, means flower, but to us, it's a name that's run in our family for generations. And through my mother's side, we're actually descended from Flora MacDonald, who rescued Bonnie Prince Charlie from the Redcoats in 1745. And so it's a name that to us doesn't just mean flower, but it does, of course, also in Latin mean flower. And she was very, very, very fond of flowers. And that also is appropriate here, because in the piece here, there are no vandals. And I feel that the bulbs that we planted around her grave here will be left in peace to grow and to flower, and nobody will come and desecrate them. And, I think if she could have had a hand in saying where her ashes were to be, she'd have chosen here.
Thank you.
gems you're here and mark it draw as ye mark fear, lassie.